Okay, the next style of dial indicator, base and dial indicator, I'm going to show you that we use here occasionally in the transmission lab is from Sterrett. This is a magnetic base, but it's made for flat surfaces only. It's a Sterrett model number 657AA, and I'm using a dial indicator number 25-611J. Now, there's a couple of unique things about both of these, both the base and the dial indicator that we need to talk about. The dial indicator, first, if you use this one, notice it's in the box. It's not just flopping around in the toolbox. We've got a foam cover to take that off, or take off the foam cover, and then an insert where this very expensive, very precise dial indicator sits. Now, what's so fancy and precise about this dial indicator? Well, this dial indicator is made for very small measurements. This is made to measure in 10 thousandths of an inch measurements. So the other dial indicators that I have measure in 1 thousandth of an inch. This would divide each 1 thousandth of an inch into 10 smaller portions, and that is a 10 thousandth of an inch. So a very precise, very expensive tool. It has jeweled movement with industrial ruby bearings for long life and high accuracy. The plunger only moves a fifth of an inch. 200 thousandths of an inch is all this plunger moves. So the more precise they are, the less plunger movement there is. So we are going to use this high precision dial indicator to measure runout on some intermediate shafts in a transmission. So I've got two identical intermediate shafts here out of a Toyota Tundra AB60F transmission, and the specification for runout is 1/10,000th of an inch right here in the center. So anything more than 1/10,000th of an inch and this shaft needs to be replaced. All right, I've got a set of V blocks here that we are going to use to measure the runout of a transmission intermediate shaft. These V blocks are a matched set. They're both stamped with the number 114. So if you have multiple sets of V-blocks, you should make sure that they both have the same stamping on them as you're taking measurements. So we want to measure the runout right here on the center of this intermediate shaft. So I'm going to take this magnetic base, put it right here on the V-block, and turn on the magnet. All right, now I'll use the thumb screw here. I think I need to turn that around. So this rod that holds the dial indicator in place can come over here near where we need to take the measurement itself. Notice the rod is too short to get over here to take this measurement with the dial indicator on it. So we'll turn the shaft around in the V blocks, and now where we are going to take a measurement is right here. So I'm going to just kind of lock the small dial indicator base rod in place. Notice it has a small rod and a large rod. Now this clamp is a little bit different as far as how we connect the dial indicator to the clamp itself. It has this little threaded holding fixture right here that will unthread, and then the back of the dial indicator right here has this hole in it. We're going to position the hole in the back of the dial indicator over that threaded shaft and then screw back on the little thumb screw portion that holds it in place. So the dial indicator is attached by the back of the dial indicator, not by a plunger base like we did in my other videos on dial indicator usage. So we've got the hole right here that goes with the small rod. Get that small rod back over here. We'll take this hole, line it up. Just like that. And get it pre-positioned to where it's just about ready to go on to our intermediate shaft. Like that. Now, obviously the plunger is over here, and the intermediate shaft is back here. I can take this off and turn it around, or I can move the magnetic base to the other side of the V-block and lock it in place, and then just play with the thumb screw positioning of the rods that hold the dial indicator in place. I'm going to flip this one back over. It'll get me closer to the surface that I want to measure. So about right there is where I want this clamp, approximately. Except we want to extend the rod length enough that our plunger can be preloaded right there. So we'll lock everything in place just like that. And now we are almost ready to take a measurement. We have an adjustable dial here on the outside to zero the dial indicator. We have a little thumb screw right here to lock or loosen that outer dial so that we can zero it. Each of the little tiny marks on the base of that, or on the face of that dial indicator, indicates 1/10,000th of an inch. Each of the numbered marks indicates 1/1,000th of an inch. All right, I've got the dial indicator plunger sitting on the machine surface that I want to measure. I've got the other two machine surfaces sitting in the V blocks, and I'm going to rotate the shaft, hopefully without causing a disturbance in our reading here. So let's zoom in and let's zero that dial indicator. Okay, I've got the dial indicator zeroed. It's okay if it moves just a tiny bit as we do our initial rotating of the shaft with increments this small. Sometimes the shaft will realign itself in the V blocks, but let's take a look at how much runout we get in this particular shaft. So I'm rotating. So each little tiny mark, as I said, was 1/10,000th of an inch. We are definitely more than 1/10,000th of an inch, so this shaft is no good. And that's because I took it over to a press and bent it on purpose for this demonstration. So this is a high precision 1/10,000th of an inch capable measuring dial indicator and a flat magnetic base mount. So I've now shown you in four different videos four different style of dial indicator mounts and usage and precision of dial indicators. You don't need to run out as a new technician and buy a $300 dial indicator. You can start with the real cheap stuff if that's what you need to do. Just be aware that the precision and life of that precision varies greatly from one brand to a next to the next with some of that real inexpensive knockoff garbage that they sell at some cheap tool stores. So be aware they are not all the same. Once you're finished taking a measurement with this tool, make sure that you take it apart and put it back in the boxes where it goes. I do not want this tool left out on the workbenches. It's too expensive, too precision of a tool to be left out. So make sure that you rebox it and put it away when you're finished with my classes.